Hi, I'm Mel McCann. I live in South Australia. I am the carer for my wife, Deb, who has got lung cancer, stage four lung cancer. I'm retired now. I spent 12 years in the Air Force and then 38 years as a paramedic, which helped me a lot in this journey, which is a pretty rough piece of road at times.
So Mel, the first question about becoming a caregiver for a loved one is, what are some of the emotions that you as a carer may go through caring for your loved one?
Okay, what are some of the emotions you might go through? How many are there in the human experience? It was just, like, initially it was just devastation. We kind of, everything we thought we were doing next week, next month, whatever, just stopped. The world just stopped. And then as you start to ride a bit of a roller coaster, which is, you know, because you're trying to adjust, as a carer, you're trying to adjust how you're operating to care for someone who's trying to adjust to how their world's changing dramatically. And depending on the diagnosis with the various diseases, that could be a slow change, which gives you some time to draw a breath and adjust, but it might also be a really quick change. In our case, from Deb having an X-ray to her being operated on was a matter of days. And we just had we didn't know which way was up. You're constantly adjusting your game plan because the person you're caring for is having their game plan adjusted for them. Sometimes you've just got to take a really big breath and go, you know what, shut your mouth and walk away. Because it's the old thing that, you know, our worst behaviour comes out around the ones we love most. And I firmly believe that's because we know it's safe to vent those things. You can't vent those in public. A lot of the times, as a carer, you're going to be on the receiving end of frustration. And so you can be, sometimes you can be hurt by that. And I had to learn not to be hurt. That this was not vindictive or anything. This was just someone who was trying to cope and just was trying to cope with something that was changing almost daily. And for us, we were living in a rural Victoria and we had long transfer hours in the car each way, every day, you know, all the time. So you've got all those emotions are going to run right. And I think the really important thing here is to realise that's normal. You're not losing the bottle. You're not weak. You're not a failure because you've got all these emotions happening. You've got all those because you love someone and you're human. If you extracted either of those things from the event, you probably wouldn't have them. But here we are. We're carers for someone that we love that is suffering, and the very nature of caring for someone that is suffering is you suffer with them. Suffer a different road, but you suffer. When Deb was diagnosed, we were married. We've been married 38 years.
Wow.
And like every marriage, you know, you have your rough patches, you have your mountaintops, and you can't enjoy the mountaintops without going through the rocky roads down the bottom. But we had a great relationship. But when this came out, it rewrote that book. And we sat down and actually cut through all the rubbish, you know, I think our marriage, we're married 44 years now, and our marriage, I think, is better than it ever was because I realised that some of the stuff I was doing, like I'd get upset with her and then I'd sulk, and waste 2 days not being happy with her, realising, you know what, there's 2 days I'm like,
yeah.
So stop this rubbish, you know. Yep, you got up, you know, you're up my nose again, you know. I'm going to walk outside, water the garden, come back in, we'll have a cup of tea. And so it redefined things. And I would urge people, as far as the emotional rollercoaster you go through, don't be afraid to sit down heart to heart and go, you know what, these are the important things in our relationship, and get them sorted out and get all the things put to peace and then go from there. Don't carry rubbish you don't need, because you don't know how long you're carrying it for.
I think that's really important. And what you've just explained quite well, Mel, is the grieving process as well. And, you know, grieving doesn't just mean that you're grieving a person who has left us. it's also grieving the process of, oh, our lives have completely changed. We've got a new trajectory and we have to figure this out. We talk about self-care and, you know, just refilling your cup, so to speak. Taking that into consideration, as well as, you know, what else do you do as a carer to find support for yourself? What is the best way to find support for yourself?
Okay. A number of options in this game, in this part of it. In recent times, Lung Foundation have got their peer network up and running, which is great. I'm on the peer team, and I've been really blessed in being able to have a connection made with a person who was trying to care for their one of their family members. And they were able to ring me. They were given a number, and we were able to spend a couple of times, you know, a couple of hours on the phone, really, talking through these processes and then just giving them somewhere to actually cry and laugh and scream and just vent with someone that actually knew what was going on. So that peer network thing is a really great thing. We found Lung Foundation to be brilliant. And when we've accessed them, you don't see it as a weakness to think you need psychological support. If you've got a broken leg, you're going to get the doctor to put a splint on it.
Yeah.
If you've got a broken psyche, you need to put a splint on that as too. And we usually use clinical psychologists and things like that. So that's worth doing. I think it's really, really important to do, actually, to make sure that particular tank is running in the room. You know, it's got the right fluids in it, so to speak. And I firmly believe that they help you unpack the boxes that are inside your head. And so that's a really important thing to do. Part of that is talk to your GP about it. The GP is usually your first point of entry into the stuff. And go and talk to your GP, and they can also then access other systems to help you and get maybe a mental health plan and that in place. If you've got a trusted friend, that's really good to have too. That you can just, somewhere where you can sort of throw it all out the table. That's really important. Because as a carer, you tend to be bottling a lot of stuff up. There are some things you just can't say to your person you're caring for, your loved one. There's some things you just don't say. Same as in our setting, I'm finding out Dad doesn't tell me everything. But sometimes you need someone who can just be a bit like a sponge. Just take there, absorb what you're throwing without putting anything necessarily back. So the whole thing is, with any of the self-care, you're trying to take the level that you're coping with, try to take the level down a bit so you can run it back up when you get into the battlefield again. Yeah. So it's absolutely important to realise that the self-care is part of caring for the person you love.
Absolutely.
It's absolutely part of the game. Our son was 30-ish when Deb was diagnosed. And, you know, loves his mum to bits, obviously, and trying to tell them information without scaring the daylights out of them, and sometimes just having to sit on your hands and tell them nothing can be really, really hard, because you want to tell them, you want them to know, but you realise that they haven't been through the whole journey, so you could be loading them up with information they don't need, and then they get really concerned. So one of those other loads you've got to carry is filtering information, and the filtered information tends to build up in the recycle bin in your head. Cool. And so again, really, really important to have someone you can trust that you can unload on.
Now, I've got one last question, Mel. What is something you wish you knew when you became a carer?
I wish that we had a lot more information that we could have sort of digested early on the piece, instead of feeling for about 6 or 8 months that we were just on our own. And as we discovered more about Lung Foundation support, we found a whole lot more people would ride in exactly the same carriage.
So definitely
as soon as people get into the situation, dive into the Lung Foundation and see what they can point you at. And keep asking questions so you get answers you're happy with. If you go into a surgeon, an oncologist, or a specialist for your particular disease process you're trying to cope with, keep asking the questions until you have got your answers. But even then, there were things that we would like to have had answers for, but no one actually could give us. Like,
yeah,
how do you cope with this stigma?
Mm.
So, yeah, they're the big things I wish. And one of the big ones I see that I think is really underused at present is the peer network.
Mm-hmm.
But don't be afraid. You know, dive in, ask for help. Mm-hmm. Keep asking questions so you get the answers you want.
I like that. Thank you, Mel. It's about those open communications between everyone. There's no such thing as a silly question, because knowledge is power. And reaching out to your loved ones, whether that's a friend or a peer support or a psychologist or whatever the case may be, it's about just reaching out